acclamation and takes me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. You can help me out. Then sings my soul, over at my place delivering a load of topsoil. And I don't know about you, but when you got around Robert, you only got to start to talk, and then he's always had to go. Never had a chance really to get to know him well. And then I met this lady, Carol Dawn, part of the Blair County Christian Singles Club, and got to know her very well in a very short period of time. And we became very dear friends, and I was over to see her about a week or so before she passed. And you know, I've read in the Bible, in Psalm 116:15, where it says, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. And I'll be honest with you, it took me a long time before I could ever get a hold of that verse and make sense of it, because How can it be precious when someone's taken from you? And then one day it hit me. I'm looking at it from my point of view. I need to look at it from God's point of view. God looked down at Robert. He looked down at Carol Dawn. And he said, that's enough. It's time for you to come to your home in heaven, to your reward, where everything is perfect for all eternity. And he didn't just simply snatch them out of this world, but what he did do is he sent his angels to serenade them home. She went to sleep one night, never here to awake again, but everything was all right between her and him. So she awoke in heaven's courtyard, free from pain within. The angels gathered around her, and they took her by the hand, serenaded by angels, up to the throne, serenaded by praises to the King. Welcome to heaven. I close my eyes at night, and I try to imagine that city of brilliant lights waiting for me. But my mind cannot conceive, so I'll continue to dream till I'm transported there where I shall be, serenaded by angels up to by angels, finally at home, surrounded by praises to the King. Welcome to heaven, the angels. How about you? Are you ready to be serenaded by angels up to the throne? Serenaded by angels, find me at home, surrounded by
if my thoughts seem a bit disorganized, it's because they are. Please forgive me. But it's the only way I can cram many thoughts into a small amount of time. There is a funeral story that's recorded in the Bible that I'd like for us to briefly visit today. It's found in the 11th chapter of the Gospel of John. You will recall it is the story of the death of Lazarus, and Jesus is summoned. Only Lazarus has died and has been in the grave for 4 days. So now Jesus comes to the gravesite, and I'm reading from verse 21. Then Martha said unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now whatsoever you will ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus said unto her, Thy brother shall rise again. Martha said unto him, I know he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. But listen now to what Jesus says to her in the very next verse, because he says, today, that may impact you in a way that it never has before. Jesus responds to Martha by saying, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this, Martha? Please join me in prayer. Father, this prayer that I'm going to give as invocation may be the shortest segment in the service this evening, but it is the most important, because without you, Father, we can do nothing, and we're not going to try. We invite you into our midst. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, and his willingness to pay our sin debt, and the Holy Spirit that indwells us and gives us power to know who we are and where we're going. Thank you for these many who have come to share this remembrance with us today. We ask these things in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, his name. Amen. Good afternoon. On behalf of the family, I want to welcome you to this celebration of life service for Bob and Carol Dawn Detwiler. Truly, we thank you for coming and sharing this time of commemoration with us. We also appreciate your kind remembrances. There are two types of life we can celebrate. One is physical, temporary, and ending, and the other is spiritual, permanent, and unending. I firmly believe that if Bob and Carol Dawn could speak to us today, they would speak only of the spiritual, permanent, and unending eternal life. They would beg you to be certain that you have eternal life. So, in part, I will be addressing you on their behalf. Some 80 plus years ago, by the providence of God, Bob and Carol Dawn came into the world to sojourn here. For some, they were our parent. For some, they were family. And for still many, many more, they were good friends who impacted our lives for good. Bob and Carol Dawn started first grade together, and they graduated together. It was a class of about 27 students. Carol Dawn's mother and Bob's eventual mother-in-law was their sixth grade teacher. Their fellow students on more than one occasion have told me they were considered to be the leaders in the class. That was confirmed at graduation when the four awards that were to be handed out were given. Bob was given two, and Carol Dawn was given one. Bob preceded me in life by 11 years, so in my youth I was always compared to him. That was unfortunate for me, because Bob was very good at most things he did. Bob was a good student. He could sing, he could play the trumpet, he was athletic, he was a minister and pastor. He had many leadership skills and was involved in numerous civic and agricultural organizations. These characteristics were all enveloped in a sense of humor and a winsome personality that inherently drew people to him. Bob also had the proclivity to help the downtrodden and give them another chance. I visited Carol Dawn at Homewood very often during the last days of her life. While her speech had mostly left her, there was a voice she always conveyed to me. So when I went back to my vehicle after one visit, I wrote these words down, these four words: at peace with God. I ask you, are you at peace with God? Be assured, Carol Dawn is. I want to summarize the testimony of Bob and Carol Dawn by reading to you the lyrics of one of Bob's most favorite songs. It was written and recorded by Renee Martin, and Bob reached out to Renee and invited her to at least two of the churches he pastored. Here are the lyrics to the song, "Don't Cry for Me." If today should be the day that I breathe my final breath, don't cry for me. When my race on earth is run and they lay me down to rest, don't cry for me. 'Cause a long, long time ago, I chose heaven as my goal. I let Jesus in my soul to set me free. So when it's all been said and done, I'll be living with God's Son. don't cry for me. If you need to shed a tear, let it be for joy. Don't fear eternity. Put your faith in God above, trust in Jesus and his love, and you will see that there is hope beyond the grave, and the joy of being saved is knowing he has won the victory. I'm going to leave this world of strife, so celebrate my life. Don't cry for me. Don't cry for me. I'm in a better place. Don't cry for me. I can see Jesus' face. My time has come, but I'm not alone. I'm going home. Don't cry for me. And Jesus said to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? So I'm asking you, do you believe this?
Thank you, Alan. Individual mic. I'll go off the pulpit mic, guys. I don't know why it's doing that. But anyhow, sorry for that. To Brian and Dawn, thank you for the opportunity to stand up here. It's a privilege for me. It is. It's an honor. I don't take it lightly. Not at all. I could stand up here this evening and I could say a lot of things. But not about Bob, because I didn't know Bob like Alan did and like a lot of you all did. But I did know Miss Carol. I referred to her as Miss Carol whenever she came in here as her pastor. And so I got to know her very, very well over the years. And she became a very good friend here. She was if I could say it this way, she was a spark in the church. She really was. I remember, and I don't want to steal one of Sharon's stories. I don't know if she was going to share it tonight, but was that last Easter with the Easter bonnets? Yeah, the people here take turns handing out bulletins in the mornings, on Sunday mornings, and Sharon and Miss Carol did it one. They had it for a season there, for a time period, and on Easter, they came in with big Easter bonnets, and Miss Carol was just as happy as could be. Just joyful. She was always very pleasant, and so she was very much appreciated here. But I don't want to go on and on about her. I made a promise to her along the line, and I'll get to that promise in a moment. Before I do, I wanted to share a few things with you from the scriptures. In Isaiah 41, 10 through 13, the verses read like this. It says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Behold, all they that were incensed against thee shall be ashamed and confounded. They shall be as nothing. They that strive with thee shall perish. Thou shalt seek them and shall not find them, even them that contended with thee. They that war against thee shall be as nothing, as a thing of naught. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, Fear not, I will help thee." Dawn gave me that passage, and as I read over that passage multiple times, I realized Miss Carol lived that. She lived that. She faced the sickness. She faced the end of her life. She held on to God, or should I say it this way, God held on to her. And I've seen a lot of people with a lot of faith throughout the years. Miss Carol had one of the strongest faiths that I have ever witnessed. Today, she's in heaven. as Alan shared, she is in heaven. But it wasn't because she was a good person. Don't get the wrong idea. Not that she wasn't, you know, we talk about her, but still, she did not make it into heaven because she was a good person. She made it into heaven because she knew Jesus Christ as her Savior. That's why she got there. It was all because of him, not because of her, and I'll get to that in a moment. But there is a verse that comes to my mind whenever I think of Miss Carol. It's Philippians 1:21. It reads like this. It says, "For me to live is Christ." That's the first part. And you know what? That was kind of her life goal. For her to live was Christ, so that people could see Jesus in her. That's what she wanted to do. That's how she wanted to live. She wanted to glorify God with her life. And so, perfect? No, none of us are. But she did everything she could. She came here. I don't remember how far back when she started coming. She came and she had a lot of questions. And I told Brian, I've never seen such a spiritual sponge in all my life. As I would teach the scriptures, she would absorb as much as what she possibly could. She just kept absorbing and absorbing. And I could see this growth within her life. And the more you looked at her, the more you could see the life of Christ reflected through her life. That was her desire, to glorify her Savior with her life. And Miss Carol did that. The end of that verse says this, "And to die is gain. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." It's a pretty powerful statement. And I want you to think about that for a moment. Her death was definitely a gain for her. You say, well, what did she gain? Let me just run down a list, if I could, and then I'll get to the promise that I made. Number one, she gained freedom from her suffering. There's no more suffering where she's at. None whatsoever. She got freed from that body where the sickness was in, the disease was in. She's no longer suffering. Complete freedom from that. Number two, and I love this thought, she gained spiritual sight. Her faith became sight. She was walking by faith here, not seeing what awaited her on the other side. But when I would teach from the scriptures and we would talk about eternity, she just grasped onto that and she would hold on to that. And now she knows what that's all about. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:8, it says, "We are confident, I say, and willing rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord." As Mr. Tom sang, serenaded by angels, she was escorted right into the presence of the Lord the moment that she died. Nothing in between. She went there immediately into his presence. Number four, she gained a new home. She gained a new home. She had a wonderful farm, but she gained a new home that has been built by the Creator of the universe. John 14:1-3, listen to what Jesus said. He said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions." That means rooms. "If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Miss Carol has an eternal home now, not built with hands of this world, but built by the Creator himself. Far more spectacular than anything that you and I can ever begin to imagine. The fifth thing she gained was an eternal inheritance. The things that we have here, they pass away, don't they? We gather them, we accumulate as much as we can, and we die, and it gets left to somebody else. And you don't even know, based on what Solomon says in the book of Ecclesiastes, you don't know if that person's going to be a fool or not, and if they're even going to abuse or take care of what you let to them. You take nothing with you. But Miss Carol, she took nothing. The farm's still here. However, she gained an eternal inheritance, one that is incorruptible, undefiled, and that will never fade away. Never. Absolutely never. So back to Philippians 1:21. For her to live was Christ, and to die was gain. And it was a great gain for Miss Carol. But none of that, as I said, was because of her goodness. None of it. It was because she knew Christ as her Savior. before she had passed, and along the line, I had promised to her that if whenever she passed someday, if there would be an opportunity to speak at her service, that I would be that I would be more than happy to share the gospel with you folks. Because you see, she had a desire, she had a burden in her heart, that she wanted to know that her family and that her friends would also one day, when they died, step into the presence of the Lord so that she could see him again. So let me ask you a question. Let me pick your brain for a moment. If you died today, where would you be? Where would you be? Are you guessing in your mind? Are you saying, well, I hope that I would be in heaven, but I'm really not sure where I would be? You know, the Bible tells us that we can be sure. We can be 100% sure that we can have a relationship with Christ. So here's what I want to do for you. I want to share with you how you too can know that when you close your eyes in death, that you will be absent from the body and will be present with the Lord. So I want to share the gospel with you. The word gospel means good news. But before you get the good news, you have to get bad news. I often refer to it like this. If you go into a jewelry store to look at a diamond, they will pull out probably a piece of black velvet, and they will take the diamond and they will lay it against the black velvet, because the black velvet will show the many facets of the diamond, and then they put all the lights on it and it glistens, and then they say, just write the check out for this much and it's yours. But they got the black behind it because that makes it stand out. So let me do something. Let me paint a dark picture, and I want you to stay with me. I want you to keep this square in your mind, if you could, because I'm going to reveal some things to you that may be a shock to you that you don't know, but you need to know. Number one is this. Someday you are going to die, and whenever you die, after death, you will face a judgment. You will stand before your Creator someday. Listen, if you would, to Hebrews 9:27. It says, and as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. Did you hear that? After this, the judgment. You will stand before God someday, and you will be held accountable for this life that you live here. I'll get to that in a moment. And the problem is this, you don't know when you're going to die. In Job chapter 14, verses 1 and 2, and then verse 5, we read this. Man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. How true that is. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth as a shadow and continueth not. Listen to verse 5. Seeing his days are determined, the number of his months are with thee. Thou hast appointed his bounds that he cannot pass. You know what that means? That God has an appointed day for you to die. He has set the boundaries. Seeing his days are determined. Let me make it more personal. Your days are determined. The number of your months are with God. God has appointed your bounds, and you cannot pass. You cannot go beyond the boundary. You don't know when it's coming, but I know this. When that day comes, you will leave this world. It's exactly what the Bible says. And it doesn't matter who you are surrounded by. It doesn't matter how many doctors that there might be in your family. It makes no difference. Or even in your presence. When that day comes, you will leave this world. And let me go back to that first point. After death comes the judgment. You will stand before the Lord one day. Now, let me go a little bit further with that. You are guilty of sin. Romans 3:23 says this, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Everybody that is in this room, including the guy that you're looking at right now, is guilty of sin. We're all sinners. We've all sinned against God. So what you need to understand is this, that sin goes on our account. So as you go through life, you accumulate what is known as a sin debt. It continues to build. Every sin that you ever commit, whether it is sins of the mind or sins of action, you know, your thoughts are even sins. anger towards somebody, according to what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, is the same as murder. Lusting after somebody, according to what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, is the same as adultery. God knows your thoughts. He knows your actions. He knows the secret sins in your life. He knows everything that you do and that you have done from the beginning of your life till the day that you reach that boundary. He knows it all. Let me take that a little step further. The sin that is in your life, the sin that we commit, it separates us from God. Isaiah 59:2 says this, "But your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear." Did you catch the end of that? That your sins have separated you from God to the point that he will not hear. Did you know that if this sin in your life is not forgiven, that the prayers that you would offer go no higher than the ceiling of the room that you're in? God will not hear if that sin is on your account. Brings me to point number 4. This is the one I want you to get. Every one of your sins has to be paid for. Everyone. God requires that every sin in our lives has to be paid for. Romans 6:23, "For the wages," which is payment, "the wages of sin is death." The payment of sin is death. Not just physical death, but even spiritual death. Separated from God. That's what that means. And if you die and all those sins are still on your account and they have not been paid for, then you will be separated from God for all eternity in a place known as the lake of fire. That's what you will experience. So we're all sinners. We're headed towards a day whenever we will die. Every one of our sins has to be paid for before we die. And whenever we die, we will face a judgment. Let me go a little further. I'm almost done with the dark picture. You cannot earn the forgiveness of sin. You cannot work for it. You cannot earn it. You cannot buy it. You cannot do that. In Ephesians 2, verses 8 and 9, it says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Did you hear that? Not of works. You cannot earn the forgiveness of sin. You cannot do it. Isaiah 64:6 says that all of our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. You cannot clean up your own life. Even if you could, let me give you an example. Let's say that you said, "Okay, I'm a sinner, and God will not accept me as a sinner. So this, from this day forward, I won't sin anymore. I'm going to draw a line in the sand, and that's it. I'll be done." You can't do that. You can't stop sinning. But if you could, let's just say that you could, and you drew the line in the sand today, and you said, "Okay, no more. And from this part of your life, clear to death, from this day forward, you never sinned again." That still would not get you into the presence of God. That would not get you into heaven, because you forgot something. All the past sins still's got to be paid for. It has to be paid for. You cannot buy that forgiveness with gold or silver. You know what the Bible says? Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. If you go back into the Old Testament and we were to come through the Old Testament, here's what you see. You see sacrifice after sacrifice after sacrifice made for the atonement for sin. Because without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness. You don't get forgiven without the shedding of blood. God requires that there be a bloodshed for our sin. That's the dark picture. If I left you there, you don't have a hope. Neither do I. We would have absolutely no hope whatsoever if I stopped right there. If the Bible stopped there, you've got no hope. But praise be to God, it does not stop there. It paints the dark picture so that we can put the diamond against it. To see the facets. Now let me give you the diamond. Regardless of your past, regardless of your present, regardless of what you will do in the future, God loves you. It makes no difference who you are, God loves you. He loves you deeply, and he wants you to be forgiven. So here's what he did. He provided a sacrifice that would come and would shed his blood so that you could be forgiven of your sins. That was his son, Jesus. John 3:16, listen to this. For God so loved the world. You put your name in there. I'll put my name in there. For God so loved Keith that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God loves me and you so much. Here's what he did. 2,000 years ago, he sent his son, Jesus Christ, into this world to die. Remember what I said? There has to be bloodshed. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission, there is no forgiveness. All those sacrifices in the Old Testament of the blood of the bulls and the goats, they were shed for sin, but they could not take away sin. They only covered it up. But along came a man by the name of Jesus Christ. John the Baptist seen him one day, and whenever he seen him, he said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." When Jesus Christ died on the cross, he died for your sins. 1 Corinthians 15:3-4 say this, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." Jesus died for you. He died so that you could have a Savior. He died so that Miss Carol could have a Savior. And she understood that, and she put her faith in that, in what Jesus did on the cross. Because you see, that's how we're forgiven, not by works, but we're forgiven by trusting in him, by faith. Faith and faith alone, that's it. You don't even have to walk an aisle. You don't have to fill out a decision card. You don't even need to get out of your seat. All you need to do is believe that Christ died in your place on the cross, repent of your sins, and put your faith in him, and believe that he was your substitute that died in your place on the cross. That's how you're forgiven. That is how you are forgiven. John 1:12 says, "But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." In Acts 16, there was a Philippian jailer that asked the Apostle Paul, "What must I do to be saved?" And Paul said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." You say, that's pretty simple. Sure it is. Simple for us. It wasn't simple for God, because it cost him the very best that he had. He gave the very best he had so that you and I could be forgiven of our sins. Understand that. That's what he did for us. He died for you. Miss Carol would say, if she were here today, she'd say this to you: make sure you accept that gift, because that's what it is now. It is a free gift. The wage, Romans 6:23 again, "For the wages of sin is death." Now listen to the rest of the verse. "But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." It's a gift that God offers to you. Let me illustrate it for a moment, if I could. This is the best way that I know how. I'll use a credit card. Understand, this is just an illustration. You're not getting this card, okay? I'll tell you why I said that in a moment. Let's say that I brought one of these for everybody. It's a Sam's Club card. Let's say it's got an unlimited amount. You can charge on it whatever you want. It is limitless. You take it, whatever you put on it, I'll pay it. I'll cover it all. It never expires. And if for some reason you lose it, you come back and I'll give you another one, but you can't lose it, because once you get it, you always know where it's at. So let's just say, go with me, and let's just say I brought one of these for everybody here. And I came out and I lined them up across the stage. And I said, you know, here they are. They are free for you. They're a free gift. I want you to think with me for a moment what you would need to do to get that card. If it was a free gift, all you would need to do would be come up and take it, wouldn't you? Just receive it and believe that, hey, the guy's telling the truth. Here's the card. And you take the card and you go, and you can never top it out. It's always paid. The balances will always be paid. Could you imagine this? Think about this. Could you imagine if somebody here, whenever the service was over, they said, thanks, but no thanks. I don't want that card. You'd be scratching your head a little bit, wouldn't you? You'd say, how can they let a deal like that get away? How about I get their card? That way, just in case, I'll get two of them. It's kind of like the guy I knew that was taking his wife out to an all-you-could-eat, and he said, I'm just going to order two of them tonight because I'm hungry. And if you get that, but anyhow, if it's a free gift, all you got to do is take it. And if somebody passed it up, you'd say, that's ridiculous. You don't want to know something? There's a better offer than that laid out tonight. And that's the forgiveness of sin that God offers to you. He brought you here. That's his grace. You could have been anywhere tonight. You could have been anywhere. Something could have happened before you got here, but he allowed you to come here to hear what I said tonight because he loves you. And he wanted you to hear the gospel, the good news that Christ died for you, was buried, and rose again on the third day, so that you could have eternal life, so that you one day could see Miss Carol again. I will stop here in just a moment, but there is a verse, it's one of my favorites. It's in the book of Hebrews. It's Hebrews 2:10. I want you to listen, and I'm going to define a word, and I'm going to give you a little bit of background on the word. Hebrews 2:10 says, for it became him, speaking of God, for whom are all things and by whom are all things, and bringing many sons to glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. It's the word captain. Jesus there is called the captain of our salvation. That's an interesting word. It is the word archagos in the Greek. It doesn't mean anything to you. It will in a moment, though. Because back in biblical days, an archagos played a very important role. Every ship that would sail the seas had an archagos. An archagos was a man that was a really good swimmer. And they would keep him on a ship. And if they encountered a storm, they would go toward the shore, but they couldn't go in too far because the ship would bottom out and then it would get beat up on the rocks. So they would go as far as they could and then they would drop the anchor. Whenever they dropped the anchor, what they would do is if it got too bad, they had to evacuate the ship. They had to abandon ship, but they needed a way to get to the shore. So what they did, there was that guy called an archagos. They tied the rope around his waist. He dove into the water and he swam through the waters and he would take the rope and he would come up on the shore and he would anchor it to something solid, whether it be a rock or whether it be a tree or whatever it would be. And the other end would be anchored back to the ship. Then every man on the ship could come down the rope and they could hold onto the rope and they could endure the waves and the wind and they could make it safely to the shore. Listen to this. 2,000 years ago, God's Son, Jesus Christ, dove into the stormy waters of death. For 3 days, he was there. On the third day, he came up. Now he has made a way for you and I. He has anchored a way for us to be able to reach the far shore safely. Let me close by saying this, that some people will say to me, Pastor, well, that's a nice story and that's your way, but we got our own way. No, that's not my story. And that is not my way, that is God's way. John 14:6, Jesus said these words. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. There are not multiple ways. There's not a way for the Methodists and a way for the Catholics and a way for the Baptists and a way for the Presbyterians. That's not the way it works. There's one way into the presence of God, and that's through his Son, Jesus Christ. That's the only way to get there. And if Miss Carol were here tonight, here's what she would say to you. She'd say, don't you dare pass that up because this place is absolutely spectacular. And I want to be here with you. I want you here with me so that we can sing our praises to God and never suffer again and spend eternity with our Lord. I want you here. That's what she would say. I know that. That was her desire. So when this is all over tonight, and I'll say this ahead of time, that if you have any questions, you come see me. I'll be over at the meal. Of course, that's where preachers go, don't they? They go to the food. You'd say to the fried chicken, but there isn't any over there. So you just look over there. I'll be around. But you come if you got a question. You come. One of the last funerals that I did, I was over there, and there was a lady came. It was a lady that was there that I would have never picked to come talk to me about salvation. She had purple hair. She had a short black miniskirt on. She came, and there were tears coming down her face, and I said, "You need to talk," and she said, "I do." We went in my office, and she said, "Pastor, I wasn't even supposed to be here tonight, but I ended up here with a friend. I don't even know why," but she said, "I didn't know why." She said, "Now I know why. I needed that message. And I need Christ in my life." That was back a while ago. I still stay in touch with her down in Shippensburg. She's doing rather well, turned her life completely around because of that. I just say that to you. Maybe that's you tonight. You don't have the purple hair. Maybe you do. I don't know. And that's okay if you do. I'm not going to criticize. Some of you don't even have any of the color purple. I know that too. I see some shiny spots as I look back anyhow. And that's okay. But listen, God loves you. I want you to know that. Miss Carol wanted you to know that. Brian, I'm going to turn it over to you at this time. Give you a computer lesson or anything like that.
And I may need you or Christopher to come up and help me push in that space bar. thank you, Keith. Thank you, Tom. Tom, Mom just loved your music and your ministry. And whenever she had a chance to go listen to you, it was like a kid in a candy store for 2 weeks ahead of time. She really, really enjoyed your message and your talents and your music. So thank you, Tom. And Keith, your message was spot on.
Mom taught me about faith in the last 2 months. I've seen a lot of strength, but I'm going to tell you, and when she took her last breath, I know she didn't weigh 90 pounds and maybe not 80, but I've never seen strength like that. In in the Penn State wrestling room, the Lorenzo room, there's not near the strength that I saw from Mom. And you're right, Keith, it's better than a free credit card. I mean, it's there. And you just have to believe. And Mom did believe. Several years ago, Mom and Dad lost their house to a fire. And about that time, I picked up on a quote and I put it in my dad file. Because Mom and Dad had some pretty difficult tests in their life. And then they lost this house that they had. Well, we'll talk a little bit about that later. But
Winston Churchill said, success is not final, failure is not fatal. It is the courage to continue that counts. Mom's courage came from her faith. And this congregation really energized her. And I mean energized her. Okay, I was so thankful. She had several networks of energy, of sources. But I was so thankful that when she found this network, because it was closer home, and she just, well, it kept her going. She would study for each service, and she would study hard. And if it's a day before and she's not ready, you don't talk to her. Because she's going to her chair, and on the left of the chair she has about 5 or 6 reference books. On the right of the chair she has her notes. She has a light over her head, and the window behind her she has these little plastic things that when the sun hits them they make all kinds of noises and move. And that's, she was just as happy as could be studying and preparing. So I want to thank this congregation, the leadership here, all the people, for providing that for Mom and adding to her life. Pastor Keith, she really, really respected you, and Sharon, you know, one day we were at Altoona Hospital and Mom just wasn't very responsive, and boy, Sharon comes in and it was like Mom was a little kid again, and they start talking about things, and not just talking but bantering and sarcasm, and I mean I hadn't seen that from Mom. So Sharon, thank you. I know you helped Mom through some challenges, and I really appreciate that. You helped Dawn and I too. Your knowledge of the disease was helpful as we went through that. And Dawn, thank you. January, February were really difficult times for us. But with Dawn's help and leadership and friends in this congregation and everyone praying for her, Mom knew she was covered in prayer. And that she knew it. She told me, I'm covered in prayer. we were able to pretty much keep someone around her on all waking hours. So, so thank you to everyone. You mentioned a spark plug or a fire plug. I got to tell you, last winter, I came to her place, and there was tire tracks right through the middle of the yard. And where she parks her car, it's open on 3 sides, and you know the front and the back are open, and you back out. She pulls in, you back out, you go out the lane, and you go. And I said, Mom, why are these tracks, how do these tracks in the car get, or in the yard get there? She said, well, I did that. You see, it snowed, and her lane was plowed shut. But it was time to go to church. Okay? So she decided she just put that car forward and go right through the yard, onto the road, and off to church, which she did. Okay? What she didn't remember was that there is a well pit in the center of the yard. 3x3 square hole. It had a light metal cover on it. And she went right across the corners
both wheels right across that well pit, and it bent the cover. The cover doesn't fit anymore. And I just, you know, how she got the car across there, I don't know. If I would have done it, the first wheel would have been in the well pit. So Keith, if you're ever around a group of ministers and you want to brag a little bit, you can say you've had followers who will walk on water to hear your message, okay? And to Mom, it was there was no question. You just go across the yard and on to church. So Dad got his, Dad got his energy really from the community. And he was very civic minded, and he just really liked helping people and talking to people, and an advocate for people and an advocate for agriculture. He did do a lot of trucking, but I would argue that it wasn't so much getting a product from point A to point B as talking to the people at point A, filling up with gas and the people between A and B, and then actually delivering the product. But he had a real passion for really the community, and that did, he did draw strength on that. So I'd like to, there's a slide presentation. By the way, we did lose all pictures in the 2015 fire. So thanks to everyone who helped us gather pictures, and I think we got some documentation nice some documentation that's really nice for our family. So I'll try this. This is Mom. She's the smallest girl, and her sister Joyce. Joyce had three kids. Dar passed away shortly after Dad. But Melissa and Doug are here tonight. Thank you. Melissa's probably going to put on about 7,000 miles for this trip. So thank you, Melissa. But they grew up in Waterside at the Woolen Mill. And this is behind the house, this picture. Here's just a photo of the house from the mill that they grew up in. This is from behind the mill. These pictures were taken. We actually we released Joyce's and Dar's ashes, I think, a year and a half ago, and that's when these pictures were taken. This is just inside the mill. This is the farm where Dad grew up. So that's where he grew up. Mom was a active at Ruppluggle. She was a cheerleader, third girl from the left. And her classmates were always very important to her. So the alumni reunions, she'd spend, she was involved, even provided some leadership in organizing those. So it was always important to her to get together with her classmates from Ruppluggle, as well as nursing school. This is Mom. She's the girl there in front of the steam engine wheel, and her dad, Morris. Morris had bought this steam engine and fixed it up, and was a real pride for Morris. I will say that at his sale in 1972, that engine came up for sale. And Dar and I were on that engine the morning they auctioned it off. Mom bought the steam engine. It was not intended. No one planned for her to buy the steam engine. She got a bit emotional at the sale, and her hand went up in a couple winks, and all of a sudden, she has a steam engine. And this, to my knowledge, this is probably the purchase that started Dad's habit of buying things. Okay? So he started collecting things. This, I think, is the first one on the list. I used to tell him that he had a problem. There was a problem with his trailers. He had multiple trailers and multiple trucks. He said, well, what's wrong with them? I said, well, they bring stuff in, but they won't take anything out. So anyway, that's the start of Dad's collection. Dad was involved in FFA at Rubluggle, and this is a picture, I think, Chicago, maybe? Oh, okay. Well, they bought cows, and this is Uncle Ray. He's here somewhere, and Merle, Dad's dad, in front of their farm truck. Mom's senior picture. I really, as we went through these pictures, it was a good exercise for me. I really wish I would have got to know her when she was in high school and college. And I don't know, is Mary Stauffer here? She was from down in Lancaster. She doesn't travel at night. She was Mom's roommate at Philadelphia. So actually, Mom started telling us stories while she was sick that we never knew about. Okay, I need to talk to Mary a little bit more. This is her class. Mom's on the bottom, second from the left, down in Philadelphia. At her class in nursing school. And Dad ended up down to see her. This is a picture of 30th Street Station, train station in Philadelphia. Okay? This is inside 30th Street Station. So, when Mom takes Dad inside 30th Street Station, do you have any idea what he might say? Boy, you could put a lot of hay in here. Okay? And just to confirm that he was right, I did get the dimensions to that. And you could fit in that hall 715,000 bales, 50-pound bales. Now, these are tight and square as Bobby and Fred would know Dad liked them, okay? And then on the halls on either side, you could put probably another barnful too. So yes, you could fit a lot of hay in 30th Street Station. Okay, this is Mary Stauffer's yearbook from the nurses' school, and this is Mom's to Mary. Mary and Mom were roommates. She says, I'm going to end up, it's best to you and to Lee. Okay, Lee was Mary's boyfriend. Lee and Mary got married. He's an engineer, moved to Reading, then moved down to Lancaster. He designed and built them a house, which she lives in now. Lee died in 2008. Little did we know, we live in Lancaster too, and Christopher picked a Boy Scout troop, 64, in Roarstown, and we were involved in that. We didn't know anything about Mary Stauffer, but we knew about Lee Stauffer because his picture was in our scout room. Okay? We had no clue of the connection between Mom and Mary and Lee. Christopher Eagled from Troop 64. And Lee was one of the initial leaders who put together that troop. And Christopher, when Lee died, they planted a tree in honor of Lee. So it was just that connection that happened. But anyway, Mom said good luck with Lee, and we had good luck with Lee. All of us did. Mom was telling us, now she's in the hospital, she had some cognitive disorder, but when we started talking about details from nursing school, she's telling us, you know, Market Street, Chestnut Street, House 59, the L train out to Norristown, which was where her uncle was, she would go out and visit him. So Christopher and I were down to Philadelphia a couple weeks ago, and we went out to see if we could find this house 59. And sure enough, this is the dorm. This statue is in front of the dorm where Mom and Mary lived. And it's a statue that was put up in honor of the nurses at Presbyterian Hospital, which is now part of Penn Medicine. So that's there now. Mom and Dad get married. Here's a wedding party. The girl in the pink behind Joyce is another classmate from nursing school. Her name's Sally Brown. And when Mom had her first child, me, Sally gave her this rocking chair. You can see the ribbon behind there. That rocking chair was with us until the fire in 2015. And was real special. Mom always had fond feelings for Sally. Anytime we looked at this rocking chair or talked about Sally, that would put a smile on Mom's face. That's our young family. And I'm guessing that's a Clay Hall photo, probably. I wanted to put this picture in there. Dad, if you'll notice, that truck is loaded, completely loaded, okay? Well, if you can do something in one trip, why do two, right? And Dad always pushed the limit. Sometimes he pushed it beyond what the equipment would handle. Sometimes he pushed it beyond what the barn floor would handle, okay? But he did make as few trips as possible. And tractor pulling, he loved tractor pulling. He loved being with the kids. This is down in, this is down at the farm show. And that's actually one of my favorite tractors. This is a tractor that, that Dad's dad was, Dad's Pappy Detwiler, Merle Detwiler, got a patent on a seat for the Silver Kings. And for payment, he sold that patent to Silver King. And this tractor was given to them for that. This tractor, Dad had an eye for, he had an eye for at least Silver Kings. This is one of, I'm not sure I've heard five or seven, it's a prototype tractor that Silver King made, and he ended up with that tractor. And there he's pulling down in Harrisburg with it. He also has, there's a small Silver King on the front of that trailer. Dad has the next to the lowest serial number Silver King that's known to exist. This isn't that tractor, but it looks similar to that tractor. There's Christopher and Dad. It's Southern Cove. Dad met us at Williams Grove. Stephanie and I went up to see that, and this is a Case engine that thing is really been redone. It's like it just came off the assembly line. They did a nice job on that engine. The Southern Cove Power Reunion, a group of them went down to the farm show, and there was Bob Gable and Fred Bruni was there. Uncle Ray too, Jake Lakem. There's the steam engine. Another thing Dad really, really liked was education and continual development. Christopher, my son Christopher, had an interest in comm tech, communication technology. Dad found that out. We go up to visit sometime. Of course, Dad's busy back at the club grounds and announcing. And so what did he do? He says, Christopher's likes broadcast journalism, let's put him on the speaker. So so that's Christopher announcing at the Southern Cove Power Reunion. Christopher also, he graduated from Hofstra, and Dad called him up and said, hey, I think there's a spot at the Bedford Gazette. Why don't you apply? And he did. So Christopher started with the Bedford Gazette. This is the house that they lost. This wasn't just a house. You know, Dad's not the type of guy to just go out and contract someone to build a house. I mean, he wanted it done. He wanted to do it. He always liked doing stuff himself. Plus, he's really liked things to be of period. So when you redo an old house, you don't just redo it. You redo it with old stuff. If he needed wood, he would go out to an old barn and find logs and stuff and bring it back into the house. So they had a lot invested, really emotionally, in the house that they lost. And they would come down. They really were supportive of the kids. This is down in Hemfield in Lancaster. This is probably one of my favorite pictures, but this is at Ashley's wedding, and of Dawn and Ashley and Mom. This was at Raystown. While Mom was sick, she read someplace that Raystown is world famous. So she says, I want to go back to Raystown. So that was on our list. We had been there before, but we didn't make it back. But anyway, she read it was world famous, and she thought that was pretty neat. This is a family photo at a Christmas. These are Melissa's daughters and Doug, and Mom and Melissa and me. But they came in, and we went to Fall Foliage. Mom had this young spirit about her. These girls do too. They're in their mid-20s, and so we waited in line maybe an hour at Fall Foliage to get face painted. It was just fun to be around that youth and that energy. And Mom had that too. High school class reunion, these people were all very important to Mom. This is her nursing school group. They get together every year. It's been 50 couple years, and they still get together every year. And they meet at someone's place. They came up to Mom's place, Mom and Dad's. And this is a group of them. Mom's really happy. The girl on the right is Mary Stauffer, her college roommate. And here's Mary again and Mom. And Dad loved hayrides, so of course they all would do a hayride. And that's a nice picture of Dad. This is some of his legislative work. This Mom loves the moon. She would get up 3 or 4 times a night and watch the moon. Even when she was in the hospital, she was telling us the stage of the moon. Okay, and one night, this was right after she passed away. I was up there, and sure enough, the moon's coming up, and got a picture of that. And then that's Mom and Dad as we remember it. So anyway, I again want to thank everyone for their support that they gave to Mom and Dad. I want to thank everyone for helping make them have a more meaningful life, because you did. And as Keith pointed out at Mom's burial, it's not goodbye, it's see you later. But the kicker is, you still, they don't answer the phone, and we don't get phone calls. But it is see you later, Mom and Dad, and thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for coming tonight. Uncle Alan, thank you. Pastor Keith, thank you. Tom, Mom, I think she thought you were famous. Because she was always asking for your CDs. Are you out of them? Maybe one day I'll get one. To the congregation here, thank you so much. This congregation meant a lot to Mom. And family and friends, thank you for coming to help celebrate Mom and Dad. My mom grew up in a mansion in Waterside. It wasn't really a mansion. It was a large brick house with many rooms. As my mom was growing up, multiple families lived in that house with separate living quarters. So it was a large house, but not really a mansion. My dad grew up in a mansion in New Enterprise. It wasn't really a mansion. It was a large brick house with many rooms. There were times over the years that that house served as a duplex, housing multiple generations with separate living quarters. So it too was a large house, but not really a mansion. The children of Waterside and New Enterprise attended the Replogal School in New Enterprise. It was the Replogal High School where my mother and father met and became a couple. After high school, they went their separate ways. Mom went to the Presbyterian Hospital School of Nursing in Philadelphia, where she gained new friends and developed close friendships with her classmates, who, to this day, still get together for reunions. Recently, I had the opportunity to attend a small reunion with Mom and some of her classmates. If you ever want to learn anything about your parents, go to their college reunion and listen to the stories they tell. Some details you may not want to hear. The Presbyterian School of Nursing was a school that adopted the Nightingale theory of strict dress code and discipline for nurses. Mom clearly adopted the nurse discipline from her schooling and used it throughout her nursing career. I remember Mom's nurse cape and putting it on, pretending to be a nurse. The cape was heavy and made of quality material and lined with a silk lining. This gave me the impression of the important job nurses have. Her nurse cap was starched, and her nurse pins were all in place. Mom used her training and discipline as a nurse. She added to her training her personality traits of kindness, caring, and compassion for her patients. Over the years, I have appreciated my friends telling me stories of how Mom was their nurse and how she comforted them in times of distress, mostly during childbirth. I myself had that comforting experience during my own children's birth. Mom loved the OB department and specialized in childbirth labor and delivery. Mom was one of the first Lamaze instructors in the area, and she thoroughly enjoyed that work. Mom was always appreciative of every little thing. You would have thought you got her a brand new car when, in fact, you simply changed the battery in the remote start. Mom was always thinking of others and their well-being. I remember while in the hospital, she would always ask the visitors who came to visit with her, "How are you doing today?" Mom's doctors often greeted her with, "How are you doing?" Mom's response almost always, "Wonderful." One doctor chuckled and responded, "That's the best news I've heard all day." Mom showed the fruits of the Spirit in any situation she was in. She was strong and courageous, which I know was a product of her faith. Dad would visit Mom in Philadelphia while she was in nursing school. Mom often told the story of Dad's impression of the 30th Street train station saying, "How many bales of hay can you get in this building?" Dad was a farmer at heart. Dad started his college education at Penn State University. I always joked with him about attending the farmer's school. He talked a lot about the years at Penn State. When I was young, we traveled to State College. Dad would drive us through the campus at Penn State and show us where his classes were, where he lived, and of course he talked about the creamery, where he learned the secrets of making really good ice cream. Maybe even as good as Detwiler's dairy ice cream. Although Dad continued his formal education in McPherson, Kansas and Chicago, Illinois, I know from experience he valued on-the-job training. Growing up with Dad was a remote classroom, in the true sense of remote classroom. As a young person, Dad would put me in situations and walk away, leaving me to accomplish the task alone and learn how to complete the task on my own. I now know when he walked away, he always had his eye on the situation. One example of this on-the-job training was to hold a farm truck with a manual transmission on a hill. When my legs were not long enough to reach the floorboard of the truck to push the clutch or the brake, I had to hold on to the steering wheel and scooch my butt off the seat, practically swinging from the steering wheel to reach the clutch and brake. Trust me, I was scared, but got through it without any harm. Or the time he asked me to help move a tractor from one barn to another, driving the tractor on the main road. Again, my legs were not long enough to reach the clutch or the brake. Dad provided the following instructions to me. I will put your tractor in low gear. I will drive my tractor ahead. After I get to the barn, I will come back and stop your tractor. Well, if you know my father, he never missed an opportunity to stop and talk. It so happened, halfway to our destination, the neighbors were out. Dad stopped and talked, which ruined the plan of him arriving to the destination first. Of course, the only way I could get the tractor stopped was to run into something, which I did. No one was hurt, but I was afraid I had put a dent in the grill of the tractor. Fortunately, I was going too slow. I did not damage the tractor. Dad always had an eye on me, and he knew I would be safe. These are some examples of his teaching by experience in the remote classroom. Not only did he teach by experience, but he encouraged so many people. Numerous people have mentioned to me, I would have never done that if your dad hadn't encouraged me. He instilled confidence with his encouragement. Dad was also a minister, and he performed many weddings over the years. In fact, the friends who appreciated Mom's nursing skills with the delivery of their children were sometimes the ones who were also married by my father. Mom and Dad made an impact not only within our own family, but also within the community. In closing, I will remind you that Jesus said in John 14, "Do not let your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Mom and Dad are spending eternal life in their real mansion, the mansion that Jesus promised them and promises to prepare for us. Thank you for allowing us to share some of our memories and our stories. We will open up and allow you guys to share some stories and memories as well. And we'll start off by having a friend of the family, Pat Sutton, and she'll start off by sharing with a piano solo. Thank you.
Thank you.
If there's anybody that has anything they want to share, I'm going to ask you to do something. You can come up here, or you can raise up your hand, and I'll get this microphone to you. And the reason we're doing that, not to scare you, but it's being broadcast live on YouTube and different things, and then it'll be archived for the family to hold on to. But don't let that scare you. They won't. I don't think they can turn the camera around to get to you. But we at least need your voice. So, is there anybody that has anything they want to share? This is Rep Logal. You wait till I get the microphone to you. You'll wait patiently. Thank you for that.
Carol Dawn and I have been friends off and on for a long time, but the last 3 years we sort of kind of got together. We went out to eat, you know how everybody has to eat, and you go and meet somebody. And she really liked to go to different restaurants, so we went the whole way out to Mike's place. A few people know where that is. And she liked that, and she found some places she thought she just had to take Brian when he came up to visit. And we just talked about different things and had a good time together. And she talked about her faith a lot. And one of the things that I'll always remember that she said, no matter what is going on, God is in charge. And that was the way her life was. God was in charge of her life.
This is Rep Logal. Anybody else while I'm back here?
I told my sister I wouldn't talk, but she knew I would. There's so many ways I knew Carol Dawn, being related to the family for one way, and then I did her hair for many, many, many years. I cut it. And those of you know, she would go from dramatically short and then grow it out and then go back to dramatically short, and I just loved it. There was a time when I was putting beads in it. That was back before anybody was wearing beads. Carol Dawn was wearing beads. She loved that sparkle. She loved to just... anything, I think, that could start a conversation. I attended some Bible studies at her house, and the one thing I loved about doing her hair was like it was having Bible study. We would just talk about the Bible, and I learned so much from her. I just going to miss her, and I truly loved her.
Thank you. Kevin, did I see? Okay.
Bob and Carol Dawn and I grew up together, went to school together for 12 years, and we've just been friends all the time. Carol Dawn was a cheerleader, and the football team would always get her to do a big apple. And a big apple, your skirt would fly way up, you know. And then Bob and I used to plow and work together, and we were always really good friends until he beat me one night at a tractor pull. That stopped that. But I always called him about every night. I would call him and say, "What'd you do today?" And when he passed away, I really missed doing that. He was a good friend.
Somebody else. I see another hand somewhere.
I have wonderful memories of Aunt Carol Dawn and Uncle Bob, but one that really kind of sticks out, the magic of being a child and coming out from the West Coast and spending summers here with my sister and brother, was at the dairy farm. And the magic that they had an air conditioner in the house, which I thought was like a miracle in and of itself. But the bigger miracle was the creamery or whatever it would be called, and that you could go out there and there was every variety of ice cream ever imaginable, and we could have whatever we wanted. And there was something I want to say was called tea berry. Is that a real ice cream? Yeah. But it was a really clean memory, and you know, had so many wonderful times out here with the family and with Aunt Carol Dawn and Uncle Bob, and just missed them tremendously. But those are just like real magical moments in our life that they brought to us as children, because we weren't allowed to have ice cream when I was growing up, but we did out here. And whole freezer room full of it.
I just have lots of memories of my Aunt Carol Dawn and Uncle Bob, and just how sweet. You know, Aunt Carol Dawn was so sweet. Aunt Carol Dawn's my mom's sister and only sister, and I just have, she was really nurturing and kind to always to me, and she made me laugh a lot. But one thing that's really special that I, before she passed away, my brother Doug was able to come see my Aunt Carol Dawn, and I had written a note for him to read, and I just love the thought of my mom and my sister in heaven together, and I told her that that's what I believe they will be together, and that just makes me feel really joyous and happy that I was able to relay that through my brother Doug, and he was able to read that to her, and it just brings me a lot of joy, and just, you know, she brought a lot of joy to our family and was always very upbeat and joyous, so I'm just thankful for that. Thankful for that thought and a memory.
Somebody else have anything they want to share? You'll wish you had got on YouTube if you don't do it. Nobody else have anything? Okay. I got one to go with Brian's. There would be times at church when it would be like, I would get here and I would think, should we even have had church? Because it's snowing and blowing, and guess who showed up? And she came over Broomball Mountain and had to go back over until we get out of church sometimes. The roads would be covered, and I would always worry about her getting home. But she, knowing that she drove over the well and everything, I guess she was fine. She was okay on the roads. If she could off-road if she needed to. So, yeah, we appreciated her very much here. We really did. Anybody else have anything before Mr. Tom sings one song and I pray, and we'll go over to where the food's at? Anybody else have anything? Okay, Mr. Tom, I'll hand it over to you.
You know, we know that Robert and Carol Dawn both love gospel music, and I just think it would be very fitting to conclude this service by singing a gospel song that everybody knows, and we would do it in their honor and in their memory. Will you please join me? Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first began.
Prayer. I just want to invite everybody. The church has prepared a huge ham dinner and everything, so you are welcome to stay. Please do. If not, we'll be eating ham for the next week because they always send it home. So stay, hang out, comfort the family. It means so much to see this many people show up. I know what it means to Brian and Dawn. And it does my heart good to see that they get the comfort from you all being here. So here's what I want to do. I'm going to pray, and then I think we're going to let you go out the two middle doors and around by the coat rack and come in that way. That's normally, nobody's given me any different directions. So go that way. We'll let the family go first after I pray, and then we'll go over there and have fellowship time together. Let's pray. Father, Dear Lord, first of all, we thank you for this evening, for the celebration of life, for Bob and Miss Carol. Thank you for their lives, and Lord, for the influence that they had while they were here this short time on earth, though it seems like a long time whenever you look at their ages, really. Lord, life is but a vapor, as James says. Father, I pray for the family. I pray for comfort for them. Lord, it's hard when, as Brian said, mom's not there to answer the phone. Mom's not there to call you. And that leaves a tremendous void. And Lord, only you can fill it with your grace. And so I pray that you will do that. Lord, for the, if there's somebody here and they don't know Christ as Savior, might tonight be the night. Might today be the day of salvation for them. Might they put their faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ, accept him as their Savior. Lord, now bless our fellowship time over in the fellowship hall. Lord, thank you for the food, for the hands that have prepared it, those that have labored, not just today, but days ahead to get everything prepared. Lord, might you bless the food or bodies. Lord, use this time to bring comfort to the family. And then, Lord, when it's all done, when it's all over, take us all home safely, we pray. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay.